most fun you've ever had? Hi, I'm Burke Holland.
And I'm Dan Abramov.
And this is five things about deploying a React app. Number one, it's just JavaScript, so you can host it anywhere you like. You can put it on Azure or Heroku or Amazon, anywhere, and it just works. The only exception to that is if you are using a router or building a single page application with React, in which case you may have to make some modifications on the server. Why is that?
So usually client-side single page apps, they kind of hijack the address bar. So you want to show some like probably deep path like /to-do/completed that doesn't actually map to any files on the server. It's just like a logical path. And so usually people solve that by having the server always serve index.html for any unrecognized path, and then the client will pick it up on the client and figure out what to show depending on the URL.
Yeah, exactly. And you can do this with app service both on Windows and on Linux. Works either way. And that's actually in the Create React App docs, isn't
it? Yeah, so check out the user guide. It's good.
Read the docs. Why does it take so long to unlock if you...
I don't know. Don't ask me. I hate that.
All right. Number two, React apps can be rendered on the server. And if you want to render React apps on the server, how exactly can you do that?
So you can do it manually. Like, we have APIs for server rendering. But personally, I would just recommend to use a project called next.js. It's an open source project that encapsulates some ideas about how to do server rendering in an efficient way. So I recommend to check it out.
You should check out next.js. It sounds like a cool project. Number three, you can deploy React apps using some sort of continuous integration or continuous delivery service like Travis or Jenkins or Visual Studio Team Services. And what's cool about this is you can check your code into GitHub, not your build, just your code, and then have the build server pull it in, run the build, and then copy your code over to Azure App Service or wherever it actually needs to be. So in the end, you get just your build assets, not all of your code. Because you don't want to deploy your entire project to the web server. That would be bad.
I guess.
Number four, you can deploy React apps with Docker. What is Docker?
No idea.
I don't really know either. But I do know that you can deploy React apps with it, and you can check out the docs for that on Azure App Service. I do know that it's a neat way to bundle up your app and deploy it straight to App Service and have it run without having to worry about installing any of the dependencies, which is really cool. You should check that out. It's called Docker. Dan doesn't know anything about it. It's awesome. Number five, if you want to use React with Node or Express, you can use the Express React Starter project, right?
I don't know what it is. I don't officially endorse it, but maybe it's good.
See? Use Express React Starter. It's awesome. And now, a question from Twitter. Super duper. Let's take a question from Twitter. Question time.
No,
I can't do jazz hands. Brian Rinaldi is asking, for someone that's coming from another framework, like let's say Angular, for example, can you explain the difference between Flux and something like the MVC, MVVM patterns that people are used to?
So it's kind of fuzzy. So like a lot of people are not going to agree with what I say. Like some people say that Flux is MVC, and in a way, I guess it is. But I think...
What do you say?
Practically, like I would say the biggest difference is that there is top-down data flow. So like in MVC, you have these models that may link to other models that may, like view may subscribe to this, and then a view has another view and that links to a model. And so you have these kind of like connections that are not really like enforced in any particular direction. And in Flux, it's more like things, like there's a model which is called the store, and the state lives there. And it kind of goes down into components. And if components want to change something, they dispatch actions, which go back to the store. And then the store decides what the next state is. So it's more kind of streamlined. But there is also more boilerplate code you need to write, I guess.
Do you have to use Flux in order to use React?
No, you don't need to. It's just, I guess, it's a nice escape hatch when you have like deeply nested tree and you need the same kind of state in different places. So React has a way of dealing with that. Usually lift the state up to the closest common ancestor component and kind of like just let it go to shell components. But the problem with that is that if these components are too far away, it just becomes a lot of boilerplate code. And like some people don't like that, or sometimes it's not performant enough. So in this case, you might want to move state sideways out of React hierarchy and keep it in Flux, or Redux, or like any similar thing.
So Flux or Redux?
Redux is kind of different, but the data flow is basically the same. It's just written in a different way.
I'm Dan Abramov.
I don't remember your full name.
So. Oh my gosh. It's Burke Holland. Okay. I'm internet famous. I'm not as internet famous as you. Yeah. Can I get your autograph?
No.
You take a picture with me?
No.
And now you know 5 things about deploying React apps.